series event. So thank you for coming. Tonight we have Dr. David Bodenhamer. He is from the POLA Center at IUPUI. And tonight he's going to talk to us about deep mapping and spatial humanities, and maybe a little bit about the SAVI system. Thank you, guys. Welcome, Dr. Bodenhamer.
Well, thank you. It's a pleasure to be back on the Ball State campus. Our youngest son graduated from here 2002-2003. I think he was in music, performance arts, and he's now with Chanticleer, those of you who might know the classical music world.
Wow.
Yeah, he sang for Chanticleer for quite a while, and then now as the music director, he's out of San Francisco. But he always speaks very highly of his training here, his experiences here, and every time my wife and I came up to watch him perform, where she was always watching him, and I was always impressed with the quality of the performances here. They're really first rate. Well, I want to talk to you, Angie asked that I tell you something about the center that I had first before I get into the substance of my talk, which is on space, place, and time. I think that's the title of it, which has to do with the development of the spatial humanities. But POLIS is a self-supporting center begun in 1989, became self-supporting in 1993, and we have four basic areas of our work, all of which are tied together by the use of geospatial technologies, primarily GIS. And those are geoinformatics, community informatics, health geoinformatics, we're on the health campus of the IU system, and spatial humanities, and I'm a team of one in that latter area. We, since we're self-supporting, we have to do a lot of project work, grant contract work, and we've done over 700 projects for $7 million in grant and contract income. Our annual budget is about $3.5 million a year, and we do projects. We began with a focus on Central Indiana, but now we're doing projects across the world. We're a matrix organization, that is, we share a lot of common staff with about 25 full-time staff members and about 8 to 10 interns that we have at any one time. And I was talking with some colleagues here over dinner, and it turns out that there may be some opportunities for those of you who are students and want internship experiences to work with us in some of our areas of interest. The SAVI Community Information System is our community informatics area, and it's the nation's largest and most comprehensive community information system of its type. Begun in 1996, and you can see it at savi.org, SAVI.org. SAVI stands for Social Assets and Vulnerability Indicators. We began as a human services integrated database that we were working with our community partner, United Way of Central Indiana, to serve the needs of these agencies for contextual demographic information about the areas that they served. But increasingly, this system has broadened now. It covers an 11-county area. It contains over 10,000 different indicators. We can map those at about 15 to 18 different geographies. We have pre-programmed profiles of over 2,000 communities in the Central Indiana area. All of these profiles are tied to an active database so that every time one of the indicators changes within that database, it changes in the profile automatically. So that people who live in these communities or people who serve these communities will have everything from age pyramids to per capita income to anything that they might want to know about their communities at any one point. We also do a series of reports out of this, and this one looked at disparities related to income and poverty. I do encourage you to go look at it. It's a very impressive system. In fact, at one point we were serving the information needs of Des Moines, Iowa using this system. We're serving it remotely. Our work in spatial humanities has engaged also creating information systems. This was the Digital Atlas of American Religion, which was funded by a National Endowment for the Humanities grant. It turned to, just as the SAVI information system takes 30 different databases and pulls them into a highly granular system, this one, though, dealt with one primary database, and this was the Census of American Religion that was conducted by the U.S. Census Bureau from about 1896 until 1936. When someone realized, that's probably unconstitutional to ask people where they're going to church. And then in 1956, it was picked up by the National Council of Churches, and since 1960, has been done by the Glen Mary Research Center. It comes from a self-reporting body of denominational statisticians, but it's the nation's best and most comprehensive source of information about religious adherence. And we can map those down to the county level in an interactive system. But the thing that was interesting about this project was we added different kinds of visualizations than you would normally get within a GIS. GIS will give you kind of it does a lot of very interesting visualizations. It doesn't give you the ability to do tree maps, for instance, or bubble charts, or some of the other techniques that you see now quite increasingly common on something like Google Apps and others. And so we added and integrated those to provide a source for religion scholars. Since my talk is on spatial humanities, I'll just simply outline briefly what some of our other things are. Besides the NEH grant and visualizing complexity, we had an NEH Advanced Institute grant for 2012, where we worked on spatial narratives and deep maps with 12 scholars who were primarily from Europe and the United States. We have started a series on the spatial humanities that began in 2010. I should have updated this slide, and we now have 4 titles published, 3 additional titles in press, and about 4 more under contract that updates that. There is one coming out, I'm pretty sure that you're going to see in the New York Times and a number of other things because it's called The Geographies of the Holocaust. NSF project that was done by one of my friends, Ann Knowles at Middlebury, who is one of the pioneers in historical GIS, and she and some colleagues in Italy and in Canada have done a very extensive work on mapping the various camps and what all that were throughout Europe during the Nazi period. And it turns out that I think you've probably seen actually one of the early reports about a year ago that says that the density of these camps was so great that it's unlikely that any European living within those areas at the time could have denied the existence of them. I'm an editor of the International Journal of Arts and Humanities Computing, which is also we house there at Polis. We have research relationships with these universities, and we have created a virtual center for spatial humanities, which represents a partnership between Florida State University, West Virginia University, and IUPUI. It actually began because my 2 colleagues at Florida State and West Virginia and I like to get together and drink beer and talk football. So this gave us a good opportunity to do research. Now, here we go, the right thing. From historical GIS to deep mapping the emergence of spatial humanities. It's no surprise to anybody in this room that over the past 2 decades, we have experienced a data deluge unlike we have seen probably since Gutenberg invented his press. We've had, in addition to this data deluge and probably facilitating it, has been step changes in technologies that those of you who are students probably aren't nearly as aware of it as those of us who are considerably older, but the smartphones that we carry in our pockets, they weren't even thought about 10 years ago. And so this just represents the way in which our world has changed. But in addition to this data deluge and the shift in the technological base of our society, we've had an epistemological shift. Now, epistemology is simply knowledge. It's the study of knowledge. How is it that we know what we know? And previously, ever since actually the Enlightenment, we have emphasized rationality and logic as the way in which we organize our world, the way in which we understand our world. But beginning about the middle of the 20th century and increasingly toward the end of the 20th century, we began to experience what scholars have called postmodernism. And that's represented, I think, through this quote at the top from Maurice Merleau-Ponty, who says, "We know not through our intellect, but through our experience." And the postmodernist essentially said that we understand the world subjectively, that each of us have, because we are different people with different sets of experiences, we have a different take on the world. We have different perspectives, that we can't always organize the world in quite the rational, logical way that we want to, that it's a much more fluid environment, it's filled with ambiguity, that things are happening not in a linear sequence, which is what a rational structure, a logical structure suggests, but rather these things are happening simultaneously. Now, the books that we use don't capture that very well, do they? Because in a book, we're going to experience something in a linear way. And yet that's not the way we experience the world. But another important thing about this shift to postmodernism is the emphasis on agency. That is, that each of us as individuals are agents, we are actors. And we are free, we're influenced by structures, but we're also capable of removing ourselves from those structures. And because of this, there was a skepticism about the value of experts. There's a belief that somehow everybody had their own expertise. So what this has led to is a new framework for how we learn. And this, those of you who are students are experiencing this, but you may not recognize it in quite the way that I recognize it, or some of those of us who are older recognize it. We're now in an era in which we have unstructured interactions, blurred disciplinary boundaries, we don't privilege experts in the same way, we're open to experiential knowledge, and we have networked ourselves and we think of ourselves now as part of a network of investigators or collaborators in ways that certainly has been unfamiliar to my discipline of history until relatively recently. Well, the themes that have emerged from this in terms of scholarship have been the ones that are listed here. These are the ones that tend to engage at least those of us that are humanists, and actually I think it goes beyond the humanities. We recognize that, in fact, in any situation, there are multiple realities, and everything depends upon the perspective of the observer. That things are interdependent, and we're aware of that in how we have not been aware earlier. That we're engaged, that we understand intercultural, that things are connected in ways that we might not have imagined, and that they operate at different scales, in between and among different scales. And we're interested in questions of hybridity and complexity. Well, at the time all of this was happening, what was occurring within geography and those disciplines that were involved with space was the emergence of a technology that raised to the attention of a number of other people the importance of space itself as a way in which to understand the world. And this increased attention to space and spatiality occurs primarily in the 1960s because that's when this technology known as GIS emerges from a laboratory at Harvard. These technologies that support this emphasis is called the spatial turn oftentimes in literature. And GIS is a system, it's a tool that allows us to manage, analyze, and visualize the data about space, as well as an approach that focuses explicitly on space and spatial relationships. But as scholars begin to use this, especially as they began to use it outside of geography, but even within geography, and in fact, first within geography, there comes a critique of GIS. And this critique is pretty powerful. It's a critique that is really influenced by postmodernism. It says, in effect, that GIS is a computer technology that tries to force the world into zeros and ones, that tries to require the world to assume this relatively simple form. It doesn't admit ambiguity, it doesn't admit complexity. It's a reductionist technology. In fact, it's a positivist technology. It requires precise measurement and measurement that can be made again on the same object with precision as one of the ways in which you verify its existence and its reality and its usefulness. And this critique of GIS says that, in fact, there are other ways of knowing the world that are equally as valuable. Everything can't be measured. Everything can't be fitted into this. So how is it then that we get to an understanding of geospatial tools and technologies that allow us to get to these tools and technology that allow us to capture these other things? And this emergence of GI science, which is a recognition that GIS is a tool, but underneath that is a theoretical base that has to accommodate, that is actually going to be the way in which we're going to approach the world. Now, those of you who are geographers are undoubtedly cringing at my very simplistic way of describing this, but that's the way I've understood what is happening here. Well, in the humanities, we're very late. Those of us who are historians and literary scholars, we're very late to coming to this toolkit known as GIS. And we're very unaware at this point of this emergent, this critique of GIS and the emergence of GI science. But the spatial turn in the humanities is happening by the 1990s because people are recognizing that the technology, GIS, allows us to do something really quite interesting. It allows us to integrate information based upon its location. And that information doesn't have to be in the same format to be able to be placed on the map, to be able to be used in common with other information of other formats that come from the same location. It offers us the ability to visualize this information, most often on a map, but sometimes within others in other ways, that is useful for trying to understand patterns, especially. And it allows, therefore, some sort of analysis that is not open to us as a historian or as a literary scholar in textual-based work. And so there was a rapid rush into, well, I'll say a rapid rush, there was a rapid rush put on by relatively few scholars, but the emphasis was on developing tools, GIS-facilitated tools and methods that were useful for the humanist and useful for the historian. But it was always going to be a GIS-based approach. And here we had to deal with such things as changing boundaries. The fact is that those of you who are using GIS in urban planning, for instance, or using it to manage the kind of administrative boundaries that government works with, you might know that boundaries change because school districts change periodically to accommodate shifts in population. But when you put this over the entire sweep of time, you realize how often such things as national boundaries, or even state boundaries, or in the U.S., county boundaries have changed. Well, it's one thing to think about applying GIS to a modern geography, but what about when you're trying to accommodate these boundary changes? Are there ways in which we can deal with them? And sure enough, historians such as, and historical geographers such as Ian Gregory, a good friend at Lancaster University in the UK, came up with ways in which you dealt with that. Or Andreas Kunz at Mainz University in Germany. Or there was the attempt to integrate time and space, because one of the issues about GIS was that it dealt with space well, but it didn't deal with time at all. It dealt with time only as an attribute of space. And of course, the primary driver in the humanities is time. That's been the primary dimension in which we've attempted to see things. But out of this grappling with it, we began to see some new genres of scholarship emerge in history and archaeology and cultural studies. And what we were doing, in essence, was rediscovering the power of the map. Now, historians and humanists had used maps for a long time, but we had tended to forget about them. We'd certainly tended to forget about them in the 20th century when ideas became more important than space. It was during this time that space disappeared. Now, why did ideas become more important during this time? Well, think about this was a period of ideological conflict that oftentimes resulted in physical conflict, in combat, in wars. So what happens is when we rediscover the power of the map, as Richard White, a historian at Stanford, says, relationships jump out at us when they're presented in a map, in ways that we can't find when they're presented in text. So out of this understanding that GIS might offer something for the humanities, we see the development of a whole variety of things that are positioning the humanities to participate in this spatial turn. We see what I call strategic spatial data sets. Most of the censuses, national censuses, were digitized. Now, these are censuses that record demographic information by spatial units, by geographical units. And this becomes important. There were a whole variety of international collaborations that began to emerge. I've been engaged in one called ECI, the Electronic Cultural Atlas Initiative, which began in 1997 at Berkeley. And pretty quickly, this was an emphasis on how it is that you use these tools to create cultural atlases. And pretty soon, by the early part of the 21st century, it had over 800 universities worldwide and about 2,500 scholars as affiliates of this initiative. So there's a lot of interest here. There are a lot of UK and EU and National Endowment for the Humanities initiatives and the development of expert networks, especially in the European Union, and some national GIS projects, such as the US, Great Britain, China, and Germany historical GISs. In fact, if you haven't used the US historical GIS, you really ought to go and use it and look at it. The Great Britain historical GIS was the first, the one that kind of set the standard. Just an example of EKI, and here's some home pages from the various national historical GISs that are easily available for you. And then there was the emergence of geo-rectified historical maps. A very interesting man named David Rumsey, a millionaire many times over, actually made three different fortunes in three different areas, decided to retire early and pursue his interest in his map collection. He was a collector of historical maps. And he realized that, gosh, these are wonderful pieces of art, but they're wonderful treasures of important geographical and historical information. So how is it that I can make these available to people on the web? And he actually developed, bought a software company called Lunar, in which he asked them to develop a software that showed these in very high resolution over what were really pretty slow transmission lines at that point. And then he said, you know, I'd like to be able to use these within a modern GIS. So he worked out ways to geo-rectify those and to move those, allow those to be used within a modern GIS system so that you can go on his site and you can begin to see how it is that you can use GIS tools with his maps to both overlay modern and historical maps, but to do other things with them that are really quite interesting and compelling. But recently, he's begun to move his entire system into Second Life as a way of thinking about, can he make this a 3D environment? Really quite fascinating man who has done a lot to advance the kind of work that we're capable of doing. And there have been some major projects and publications that have emerged out of this early movement, early adoption of GIS by historians and humanists, not just listed a few of them there. Salem Witch Trials by Ben Ray at the University of Virginia was one of the early ones, and it continues to be used by colonial historians. Because what Ray was able to do, what Ben was able to do, was he was able to take the textual information and move it into this mapped environment and to make it interactive so that you could see in the Salem witchcraft craze of the 1680s and early 1690s where the accusers lived in relationship to the accused. And you can begin to see temporally how these accusations emerged over time. And you begin to understand that there's something at work here that is in fact spatial, because the accusers and the accused lived in relatively close proximity to each other. And there have been theories about whether this was in fact issues about land, and it turns out that Ben's work suggests that perhaps that is in fact what it was. Then there was the Stanford Spatial History Project, which still continues. Stanford University and put a lot of emphasis on trying to use techniques, spatial techniques, to understand the past. But in every one of these, as these develop, people begin to step back from them and say, you know, this is not quite turning out to be the tool that we thought it was for historical or humanities-based research. Why? There's a whole series of critiques that came forward. One is that, for the most part, all we were doing was mapping. Just mapping. And these were this was spatial primitives we were doing. We were doing point line and polygons. We weren't doing any of the other kind of advanced spatial analysis, primarily because our data didn't allow us to do that. Wasn't the tool wasn't powerful enough, but the historical data is full of holes, it's full of gaps, it's filled with ambiguity. Much of it is text-based. So how do you deal with that within this? It required a technical expertise that most historians or literary scholars didn't have. And they weren't about to invest the time that it would take to learn it. This was at a period, remember, in the early part of the 21st century, quite unlike now. GIS is much easier to use than it was then. Much easier. But even so, even today, as those of you who work at GIS know, it's still not a simple tool. This was difficult to sustain. These were expensive projects to undertake, And once you got into them, you realized that they were even more expensive than you thought. And so you were continually trying to find money. And of course, most funders are willing to fund you for 2 or 3 years, but they expect the product to be done, the project to be over. And so sustaining this was really difficult. And when you got to thinking about it, it was this entire emphasis that GIS brought was about space. It wasn't about place, inhabited space, spaces in which both people live and have histories linked to that space. And humanists are interested in place more than space. And where is time in all of this? I mentioned that GIS didn't handle time very well, and in fact, most of the humanities are based on change over time. And when they got to looking at it, they said, most people would say, gosh, there's been a lot of energy here and a lot of money spent, but what have been the contributions to knowledge? What have we learned from all of this? What we've learned seems pretty simple and seems actually pretty evident or obvious. And so most humanists simply didn't pick this tool up. Now, historians are kind of slow to come to technology anyway. It took a long time for us to embrace emails and word processing. But certainly within 10 years after those technologies emerged, we were using them quite well. But that's not been true with GIS. So, is that the end of the story? No, trying to figure out next is, where are the barriers? What have been the barriers to this, why it is that humanists haven't done this? And we realized that, first of all, there was a systems barrier. Complicated and expensive technology, required support from a variety of folks who weren't in your departments. There was the data problem. True that all these censuses have been digitized, but censuses are only one part of the story. It's only one part of the sort of evidence that historians and literary scholars use. There was the cultural issue. That is that anytime you're working with a complex technology, especially one in which you cannot be the domain expert about everything you need to know, it means that you must work in collaboration with others. It's a team-based environment. Well, most humanists go to the archives of the library and do their work by themselves. So it's an issue of how you learn to play in the sandbox with others. And then I think is actually the biggest problem, is literacy. That we as humanists weren't trained to ask spatial questions or to think spatially. And equally important, we weren't trained to think visually. Both of those can be learned, those are learned skills, but we just don't have exposure to those in most of our courses of study. But there was another reason that certainly I came to understand, and my colleagues in the Virtual Center for Spatial Humanities, and that is that there's an epistemological clash here. We approach knowledge in two quite different ways. That GIS and the rediscovery of the map, it has a vision of rigorously measurable, infinitely shareable information across temporal and spatial scales. That means that it comes out of this positivist, rationalist tradition that says we can measure everything and we can remeasure everything, and because we can do that, we can share it in wide ways and we can work with it in ways that comprises for us a common base of information. Whereas historians are much more comfortable, even though they may reject this, with postmodernism's emphasis on indeterminacy and ambiguity and fluidity, particularity and other non-standard characteristics. So the question is, can GIS fit the needs of humanists and other historians? Well, as we thought about this, maybe the issue is that if it can, it needs to be a Pareto GIS. Now, Pareto was the Italian economist of the 1920s who, when studying land distribution in Italy, came to see that 80% of the land was owned by 20% of the families of Italy. And he began to wonder whether that same ratio applied to other areas of life. And sure enough, just about everywhere he looked, this 80-20 ratio held standard. It was a common frame. that 80% of the wealth owned by 20% of the people. My wife says that I wear 20% of my clothes 80% of the time, so it's a principle that seems appropriate to her. So maybe it is that if this is the case, maybe we don't need the full analytical functionality of GIS to do what it is that we're interested in doing. Maybe we don't have to become experts in that. Maybe there are things that we can learn from it and use without having to master the entire thing, because we're never going to be able to apply it fully to the kind of data, the kind of questions that we ask. And so it is out of this that we've created this virtual center for spatial humanities, and our goal is to move beyond GIS. Recognize it as a valuable tool, but move toward a spatial humanities, which is an approach that bends the technology to our needs instead of asking us to accommodate its demands. And we have to understand, though, that this is kind of a GI science recognition that we are looking at the reciprocal influence of space and time on culture and society. Space and time shape us, and we shape space and time. It's an interaction that we're always looking to understand. So we're engaged in a process of rebooting, moving beyond the SRI, the dominant software maker in this area, trying to make GIS a multimodal that is capable of handling and expressing things in quite different ways, opening it to virtual research and immersive environments and creating collaborative spaces, and developing ultimately a new epistemology, a new way of understanding how you construct knowledge. And we call this maybe Spatial Humanities 2.0. And I'm going to start showing you something other than text slides in a moment. But it's an explicit recognition of this reciprocal influence of geographic and constructed space on society and culture, embracing all the spatial humanities that are bending them, all the spatial technologies that are bending them to our needs, multidisciplinary, and joining the humanities and GIS. And what we're looking at here is the emergent realities. And by this, and I think Franco Moretti explains it best, like maps are more than the sum of their parts. That they possess emerging qualities that are not visible at lower levels. In other words, wherever, as you begin to operate at different scales, you begin to see different things. And so one of the things that we've got to have is a humanity, a spatial humanities that shows us those different things at different scales, that brings those spatial points to the surface. Space is the meeting ground, Web 2.0 is the toolkit, and it's an open participatory framework. And we're going to be blending within this all the new approaches that are emerging out of geography and other areas, whether it's neo-geography and participatory GIS, or whether it's virtual globes, social networking, gazetteers, semantic and text mining. And here's some examples of that are already beginning to emerge. A colleague from communication studies, oddly, at Purdue, Sarin Matai, has created the Visible Past, which is a participatory GIS. And what he's done is he's created this platform that you put on your smartphone. And in this instance, he's using Normandy Beach as the example. And he's tested this actually early on in one of the anniversaries of Normandy, where you can go on the beach and using your GPS of your smartphone and the database that he's able to serve to you, you can see at that particular point what was happening on June the 6th, 1944. And veterans who are still alive and who are using that can contribute their memories to this. So it's an open platform. It's not a closed platform. It's inviting participation by the non-expert and blending that with the information being served by the expert about what we know. So you can experience June the 6th, 1944 in a virtual way. The virtual globes are popping up all over the place. Here's an example that comes from Germany, where they're repopulating the known environment with the palaces and the structures that once existed. I'm sure you've seen examples of that. Or spatial 3D, where they're reconstructing buildings. There's an interesting thing, and I probably should have put that slide up here, of Notre Dame, where you can go into this space now and you can fly around the space. You can experience the space virtually. as it existed in, I think it was 1600s, 1700s. Bernie Fisher at IU, but used to be at UCLA, has created the Digital Roman Forum. And what you see at the bottom is the forum as it exists today. This is the photographic record of that. And the virtual forum, that is, as it's been reconstructed based upon everything we know, obviously from the footprints, from the type of stone, from the text and textual information about that. What's interesting about this is that Bernie has also given us the shadows. He's given us how the Roman Forum looked, not just in its density, but at how it looked at 10 o'clock, how it looked at noon, how it looked at 2 o'clock, how it looked at 4. And by matching it and by syncing it with the video, and this is a video that is on the bottom there, as you go through the Roman Forum as it exists today, you will be going through the virtual forum. Now, what's happened at UCLA with this is that some scholars of ancient Rome have taken this, and they recognize the value of the funeral oration in not just simply Roman literature, but in Roman politics. And they knew that the important funeral orations were always given at the forum, and they know where they were given. And so they've begun to take the virtual Roman forum and using physical acoustical physics have begun to understand how far a voice could project given the mass of those buildings. So they understand something, they're beginning to understand something about the class structure of Rome, because they know that obviously these words were being spoken not just to the common man, they were being spoken primarily to the ruling elite. And so they know where that ruling elite was going to cluster within the forum. And because they knew that these funeral orations took place at different parts in the forum depending upon who the person was, they understand how far the message was intended to go, to be broadcast. And that's something we couldn't have experienced without this. And notice, too, that it's this word experience. This is not something that we would get by reading text, or if we got it, we would each get it in a somewhat different way. But now we can experience the spoken word within this virtual environment and gain something of the emotion that we can imagine people felt when they first heard those words. Or augmented reality. This is occurring actually quite commonly now. And the first time I ever saw it was with the British, I think it was the British Museum or the British Libraries thing, where you could actually walk around London, and if you saw an iconic symbol, whether it was, it could have been a historical building or something, you could hold your smartphone up to it and your camera. And if the British Library had a photograph from a different time about that space, it would feed it to you. So you could see how the building looked then and how it looks now with your own eye. See how it looks now and see how it looks then, which is what that's representing here. My colleague at West Virginia University, Trevor Harris, has actually taken GIS into a cave, a computer augmented virtual environment. He's placed Morgantown in there, 19th century Morgantown, into that cave. And you, by putting on those goggles and stepping into it, you can imagine, you can feel yourself walking through 19th century Morgantown. He has some doctoral students who have been working with this on for their own dissertations. And some of them begin to think about how it is that you introduce smell into that environment. How do you make that environment appear to be as cloudy and smoggy as we knew it had to be, because everything was fueled by coal? And so when we have some literature from that period that represents that, the smells are important because there are a lot of slaughterhouses in Morgantown in 19th century. So you know that and the stench that came from that had to be at times overpowering. The importance is it's a sense of being there. It's not just reading about it, it's placing yourself in that environment. What do we know when we do that? How do we know it? What's different about that? Now, scholars are moving, historians and humanists are moving, thinking about how it is that we place this within a gaming environment, a serious gaming environment. At Queensland University in Australia, they're working actively to move this into Second Life. Move GIS into Second Life. They're doing it there with how it is that you experience the outback in Second Life and some of the travel tales related to the outback. And what's interesting is the development just fairly recently of Facebook buying Oculus Rift or Oculus VR, which is that headset which you're going to be able to place on and now get the full range, the peripheral vision, and not just the fairly restricted vision of much VR headsets. And they're working quite rapidly, I understand, to solve the problem of your body disappearing when you look down, so that you actually continue to see your body in that space and not just simply experience it. So 5 years from now, your nieces and nephews are going to have that on their Christmas wish list for Xbox. So this is placing us in a world in which we can begin to experience that world spatially and not just simply through tech. So what's emerging today are these new and exciting forms of convergence that are focused on geocultural spaces or places, and new types of scholarship are emerging, new types of ways of understanding our world. The Vision of Britain site comes from the historical, the Great Britain Historical GIS, and if you go to that site, and I encourage you to do that, it comes out of that very first expression of the Great Britain Historical GIS in which they map census data. Mapped it according to known geographies. But now what they've done is they've taken that information and they've mixed it with travel writing, with historical maps, with election results, census reports, and all of those things that you can experience about those places in Great Britain across time. All of that information, GIS is part of that, but it's been augmented. We've gone beyond GIS in building this important way of trying to understand Britain across time. Ian Gregory, I mentioned him earlier, Lancaster University is thinking about, he's a big European Union grant, about how it is that we can begin to mine text, use data mining on text, and to pull that information into a GIS. And here he's using the Romantic poets, who are the ones who popularized the Lake District in the late 18th and early 19th century, the Wordsworths and Coleridge. The Lake District, for those of you who haven't been, is a very picturesque place. And in fact, tourists are always taking photographs of these places that are. What they've discovered through this is that they're taking pictures of the very same places that Wordsworth and Coleridge and the other Romantic poets made famous. Now the question becomes, did Wordsworth and others make those famous because they had the same kind of experience a tourist have today? Or are tourists taking those pictures because Wordsworth and Coleridge made them famous? That's the real issue about where's the cause and effect portion here. Increasingly, what they're understanding is that now they're moving this, all of this, including the words, into a 3D environment, into an environment where you can begin to see the topography of the space in a way, and to experience this, and to see whether or not certain words are associated with certain places in ways that are consistent. And thereby the poets are quite consciously trying to evoke this sense, or whether they're simply kind of communing with nature the way that we thought, and romanticizing nature in the way that we thought. What's interesting too is they're also understanding that the railroads are coming here at the same time. So they're adding information about the railroads, and there's a connection here between the popularization of this, the development of the tourist industry in the 19th century, and all of this. It's all coming together within this spatial environment. Or there's the hypercities, and I would encourage those of you interested to go here. This is a tool that's been developed at UCLA that tries to bring all of these things together in one common web environment, using GIS as one piece, but only one piece, of this in a spatial environment suitable for the humanities. And of course, there's the kind of new scholarship, and I quite consciously put my book there in the very center, so it's still available, as well as the journal that I edit there on the far right-hand side. But these are the books that have just come out over the past four or five years now, in which historians are grappling with space in different kind of ways, using GIS but going beyond GIS. New forms of scholarship. A friend of mine, Phil Etherington, at Southern California, University of Southern California, created a traditional article in the American Historical Review and then created a web expression that was much more interactive of it, so that people could go to the article, read the traditional way of presenting it, go to the web or digital expression, and see what they learned differently by experience in that. There are new kinds of visualizations. Zephyr Frank, who is now the director of the Center for Spatial History at Stanford, has created some of these. So these don't look like GIS maps, do they? But they're maps. They're mapping of spatial environments, including now use of the spatial exploratory spatial data analysis segment, which we, by the way, have just built into SAC. New kind of map forms, sound maps are emerging. Maps that allow us to experience public history. This walking through time site, it's a British site that allows you, as you're walking down the street, to see all the historical maps that existed of that place that you're walking through, so that you can see what it looked like in 1640 or 1770 or whatever. In New York City, there's the City of Memory site, where the same kind of pictorial information or image information is available, located or tagged to space using your GPS, but allowing you to contribute the memories that you have had of that space in previous times or in the time that you're experiencing it at that point. So this is opening a lot of opportunities for the spatial humanities. Life paths and spatial narratives, that is, how do you trace people across space and time? How do we construct narratives that recognize the importance of space in the ways in which society has constructed itself, whether it's the virtual reality or gaming and simulations. And the thing that I have been most interested in is this concept of deep mapping and deep contingency. The issue has become one of how it is, because once we have something in a mapped environment, we've lost track, or we've lost the ability to see what was left out, to see what the options were that people had within that environment before they chose a certain path. Imagine a battle. Within that battle, officers are making certain decisions, and men and women are making certain decisions about actions that they're going to take. In every one of those, situations, they have several options. But when they take an action, it forecloses those options. And what we focus on is the action, sometimes forgetting about the choices they have. So the deep map makes those choices visible too. It keeps them available to us. It brings together space and time in a way. It operates across multiple scales, recognizes alternate schemes, and it's really focused on a much more dynamic context to understand this interaction of space and time. And out of this, we think, we can build better spatial narratives, whether it's through things such as May 1 and at Oklahoma and May Poquan at Illinois, working on time geography, whether it's in bringing in techniques like that, or whether it's the kind of text mapping that is taking place. There's a big ERC project now that I was just reviewing it this afternoon for a competition that is embodied strictly on text mapping, ancient text, because in the ancient world there were no maps. All the geographical places were described in text. So how do you pull out these textual references and create and understand concepts of space that the ancient people had? All of these things then are important kinds of places where I think we're moving, and we're going to be taking advantage of all of these new technologies that are available to us, some of which I've already shown to you. Where out of this, I think, is coming new collaboratories, new ways in which we're going to work together as scholars. And the purposes of all this is to contextualize our information, making sure that we're always aware of the context, including the spatial context out of which events emerge, using this to build hypotheses or to raise questions and to create narration that is flexible. Because we know that in any environment, including this room, that I have a different perspective than you have. And we each are taking away from this and experience something different. How do we build an environment that keeps all of those experiences alive to us until we have chosen the ones that we think are most important as we build our interpretation or our argument out of what it is that has been accomplished here or not accomplished tonight? Here's kind of the structure that we think we're moving toward. We are moving toward in building this. It's kind of our deep mapping platform. In fact, we call actually a deep mapping as a platform, a process, and a product. It's not just this platform of integrated tools, it's also the process, the methods that we're going to use, and the product, of course, is the final expression of that work. So, when you look at the special humanities, I really believe it's a unique postmodern scholarship. To me, it's good, but I'm a true believer. To me, it's going to be the way we do our scholarship in the future, mainly because we have the ability to do that. These are not tools we've invented, but these are tools we're going to appropriate and tools we're going to put to our use. Because I think it's going to lead us into a different understanding of the questions that have engaged us. It's going to lead us to an experience with those questions and not just simply a logical engagement with them. So, thank you very much for your attention. But this is kind of my pitch.
Well, thank you all for coming. If you're interested in being on our mailing list for the GIS events that are going on campus, or if you want to be able to see our blog, I do have some flyers, but you can email me and I'll put you on. It's kind of like a listserv, and I'll give you access to the blog or give you the link to it. So if you're interested in being on the GIS Knowledge Group, other than that, thank you so much for coming tonight. We really, really appreciate it. Do you have any questions?
Yeah, maybe we can do a few questions.
Okay.
Are you open for a few
questions? Okay. Anyone have questions?
I have a question.
All right.
Okay. So I approach this, obviously, from the point of view of a geographer, a human geographer, but someone who situates his own work in social science but recognizes the critical postmodern epistemologies that you talk about. And I want to gently push you on this issue of engagement with technologies that I would argue are still positivistic, bound by the demands of measurement, and very much focused on space over time.
Mm-hmm.
So these were the critiques that you had said were, we got to get past just mapping, and now we have this virtualization, this three-dimensional, this immersive kind of movement, which I would suggest is happening apart from the engagement of humanities scholars and historians. How is this really a different engagement than what happened before?
Well, you're quite correct if I'm understanding your comment properly. In the sense that these are computing technologies, so they're all ultimately reduced to zeros and ones. That's exactly correct. What is happening now, though, is we're developing out of that technology, we're developing a much more flexible instrument by which we can reconstruct or by which we can construct an environment that we want to experience or to explore. GIS requires that we stick within a certain framework for that. These new technologies don't. They put us much more into a world of experience and emotion than does a typical mapped environment through GIS. The other thing that is happening is I will concede that nothing happens without the kind of rule-based programming that occurs, but oftentimes, or at least as I understand, I'm not a computer scientist, but as I understand my friends, what is increasingly happening is role-based as opposed to rule-based technologies. Role-based technologies mean that these have the ability to learn and to adapt on their own. Obviously, there are certain ways in which they're doing that have been programmed for them, but in some of the instances, and this has especially been true in the biomedical field, there have actually been the development of new compounds that have not been programmed. And that has been, at least, again, I'm relying on what my informatics friends tell me. And in fact, if that's true, then this means that these machines are capable of learning and constructing new knowledge that is quite separate, new expressions that are quite separate more than what we have imagined for them. Now that's a threatening as well as an exciting possibility. But admittedly, the issue now, I think, is how do you provide something that gives us different ways of seeing space, but more importantly, different ways of experiencing space than what GIS does. So I guess that would be my response. Thank you.
It seems as though a lot of the information or the input could be based off past experiences and past information. It seems as though, as you just said, it seems like you can almost be a tool to predict what may happen in the future based off the present and the past. Do you see that sort of?
Yeah, historians say we never try to do that, that's foolish. But of course, we're always writing to do that, right? I mean, that's what we're hoping is that what we have done is learn something from the past that helps us shape our actions quite differently. Whether we get to the kind of predictive modeling that I think you're talking about is probably not going to be what most historians, including myself, would think would even be possible or desirable. Simply because you don't have to be a postmodernist to recognize that we're all agents. We're all agents that are constrained by culture and constrained by other things, but nonetheless, we have a wide degree of flexibility in the way we act. And those things can't be predicted quite as easily as we might like to think.
I have a quick question. Early you talked about space and place, mm-hmm. and the difference, and as we continued on listening, it became space with experience and some of those. Can you, obviously I'm interested in the language, can you talk a little bit more about when that might become place instead of experiential space?
Space is really an abstract concept. To me, it's the only thing that becomes real and tangible in a certain way, but meaningful to us as humans are those places, those spaces we occupy, and that we invest with some meaning. And oftentimes, those meanings can be memories that we have, those meanings can be experiences that we have, but that's what constitutes place. And this is what Yves Twan and others have said. It's really that place has an emotional component to it that space does not.
And as you move further into these, do you anticipate maybe some of those become places instead of spaces, I guess is what I'm...
You mean whether these become virtual
asking.
Places? all I can do is just, you know, reflect on what my grandson, when he plays his games, he's in a place.
Yeah.
He's in a place, and that place is absolutely real to him. He's invested his emotions, and he has memories constructed out of it. So, sure, I can see that.
When we're dealing with this from a historical point of view, one of the things we also talk about is the ways in which the meanings associated with these spaces are contested.
Mm-hmm.
So for instance, in the Omaha Beach model, mm-hmm. is there a way to accommodate sets of memories that conflict? Or are there ways in your deep mapping platform
yes.
where you're going to sort of do
sure,
this?
Sure, absolutely, yeah. You're exactly right. Contested, it's not just contested, we're contested space, contested place, contested meaning, all of this has to be part of deep mapping. That's part of the, when you talk about ambiguities and uncertainty, part of what's involved there is the fact that there are contestations always
mm-hmm.
over these, the ways in which we describe things, the ways in which we relate things to each other, the ways in which we interact with people and things. All of these things are particular in quite ways that lead to that conflict ultimately. So absolutely, a deep map can exist without that being a central element.
How do you visualize that?
That's a good point.
and I
wish I could tell you. I mean, I give the critique that we're not visual thinkers, and I admit being guilty here. I mean, it's interesting. When I read something, I'm sure this is probably true with most of you, we immediately form visual images of that. But those visual images, I'm sure, are cued to our own experiences. They're not easily transferable. But how do you create an environment that has that kind of fluidity to it, that has that sort of the ability to rapidly visualize what it is that something has meant? I'll be honest, I don't know how to do that. But this is where I think that we as historians have to embrace the team. I mean, because
right.
there are people who are expert in visualization, and they have ways of doing so that, as long as it's not scientific visualization, which I do not understand at all, but visualization that has that is more human. That's not a good answer, I know.
Well, I know there's scripting in 3D immersion environments and stuff over here where you can have two different people come in and have a different experience in the same space.
Mm-hmm.
And that scripting is getting more sophisticated,
mm-hmm,
to the point where, you know, the space would actually look different, operate differently,
mm-hmm,
in different contexts. So.
No, that's true. But I mean, how you do it technically, I'm not sure. Yeah.
And whether
it needs to be done photorealistically, I don't think it's true. I think it can be done with abstract visualizations. It depends upon what the questions you're asking and the level of sophistication of your user.
So you've described all of these different spatial humanities projects, and I'm sure there's many, many more out there. Are there any efforts being made to make them all centrally discoverable in some way? It seems as though you kind of have to know about the existence and know of the site or happen upon them through a nice Google search to discover them. I guess that's sort of like a librarian-ish question, but I'm just wondering if there was somebody who was interested in exploring these kind of spaces and they didn't really know where to start.
Mm-hmm.
Is there one sort of way that they're being cataloged and described or presented?
Yeah, I wish I could tell you yes, but the simple answer is no. There are some sites that have tried to compile bibliographies in a rather traditional way of those writings about these particular projects, but one of the difficulties, I'm sure, has been that some of these projects have relatively short active lives and pretty limited shelf lives, because ultimately they have to be sustained, they have to be migrated to different servers, they have to be, all of this, somebody has to take care of them. They have to curate them. And I don't think we have the structure yet to make that happen effectively. I mean, the way that I find about them, because I'm embedded in a number of networks, but it's increasingly true that you can do Google searches and find them also, because almost all of these projects will have a web expression. It's not a good answer, but it's not, but it's the best I can offer.
I seem to remember that when Bernie Fisher was at UVA, he didn't start a repository for virtual environments.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it's not exhaustive or anything, but things he was related with, which I'm sure some degree.
Yeah, and I don't think that has gone very far.
Right. But the idea was that it's definitely needed. I don't know how, who's going to do that.
There is an effort. Now, whether it's going to succeed or not, I don't know. It has a lot of money behind it, and it has a lot of very influential people, and that's the Digital Public Library of America, DPLA. You can go look it up on the web, and it's only about a year old. But its aim is to access through this, it's not just a portal, I think they have arrangements with the various libraries that are part of this to curate these things, these digital objects. That's probably going to be the place where you might discover them in the future. But it's really the issue of curation, I think, that as much as what the movie is anything, because there have been efforts to pull together lists of exemplary projects, and within about 2 or 3 years, all the URLs are dead. I mean, they're going nowhere.
Sure.
This may be just true of, right, we're at the dawn of this age. We don't have the infrastructure yet. We have more ideas than infrastructure. Yes?
Is there much work being done? I know that there's a library now that collects World War II veterans, basically their memories, so that they're not lost anymore. Is there any attempt now to try and take those kinds of memories and tie them? You made reference to Omaha and so forth. But on a grander scale, you were talking about, and I know Jim was talking about, these conflicting ideas, but almost in a genealogical way, to tie places with people and now to map out lives?
Mm. There must be, I don't know about it, but I'd be amazed if there weren't something.
Unless you'd had life stories just written on there, and my first thought was, it would be impressive to literally knit mankind individually together.
Mm-hmm.
Impressive times.
Yeah. Good point. attendance?
Yeah,